morning everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah, today class is more of a revision class. More of a revision class. We talked about this last time, but I thought we went too fast. So I wanted to repeat again because it's the most important question for you in your theory and also for clinicals also it's important. So I wanted to repeat it again in a little bit detail. And one of you messaged me regarding internal results that will be announced because some of you have complained that I am not able to log in and couldn't give the exam. We are thinking about the alternative. Then the results will be announced. Okay. Now, right now, coming to the class. So what is tonsillectomy? Tonsillectomy is nothing but a surgical procedure in which tonsils are removed, as simple as that. So, regarding tonsillectomy, the most favorite question asked in your examination, either in theory or in practice, is about the indications. So, we go through them in detail. So, the indications for tonsillectomy are divided into local, focal, systemic, and some other miscellaneous conditions. So, coming to local. Local indications means which are related to pathology within the tonsil. So, the examples for these local conditions are obstruction to respiration or deglutition. As we discussed in chronic tonsillitis, when the tonsil size is of grade 4, it approximates with the opposite tonsil. So there is obstruction for both food passage and air passage. So obstruction for food passage causes dysphagia. Obstruction for airway causes dyspnea. So patient complains with either dyspnea or dysphagia. Then the second indication is chronic tonsillitis. So chronic tonsillitis may have several acute exacerbations. If the number of acute exacerbations go beyond 5 attacks in a period of 1 year, it becomes an indication for tonsillectomy. The next one is following an attack of Quincy. I told you we talked about this. Quincy is nothing but peritonsillar abscess. So any condition of this peritonsillar abscess, after initial treatment of draining the abscess, we advise the patient to get a tonsillectomy done. Mostly we advise the tonsillectomy after 3 weeks of subsiding of the symptoms post-drainage, post-incision and drainage. This is known as interval tonsillectomy. That is tonsillectomy performed in a case of Quincy at the end of 3rd week from the subsiding of the symptoms. This is known as interval tonsillectomy. And the other and another important indication is in this current scenario, this is not so much important because we are giving the vaccination for diphtheria. So the number of carriers and cases of diphtheria have come to very minimum now. So it is very rare to see a diphtheria case now. But in earlier days, people who are considered as carrier for diphtheria are also advised to go for tonsillectomy. Other indications are tonsillolith. So, tonsillolith, we have discussed before in the last class. When the person presents with a recurrent infections of a single tonsil and person is diagnosed to have a tonsillolith and the pain is not subsiding with conservative treatment, we'll ask the patient to go for tonsil. Similarly with the tonsillar cyst. Now coming to foreign body tonsil. So whenever person complains of ingestion of a foreign body, the commonest area you look for in the oropharynx is tonsil. It's the commonest site for lodging of the foreign body. And the commonest foreign body that lodges there is fish bone. So patient comes with history of consumption of fish. Post the consumption, patient complains of pain, dysphagia, and also odynophagia. So whenever you examine in these patients, most of the times you see the tonsil get lodged into the foreign body is seen getting lodged into the tonsil. In normal conditions, they can simply use a forceps and you can remove. If this foreign body becomes difficult to remove, then we advise the patient to go for a tonsillectomy to remove the tonsil along with the foreign body. And the other indications are other benign tumors. Benign tumors can occur anywhere, similarly over the tonsil. So if the tonsil is showing any signs of having a benign tumor, we'll excise and send for biopsy. Similar is the case with suspected malignancy. And the most important one is sleep apnea syndrome. So in a patient with grade 4 tonsil hypertrophy or grade 3, patient has difficulty in breathing. Along with that, there is obstruction of airway during sleep causing apneic stress. This is known as sleep apnea syndrome. Even this sleep apnea syndrome also forms one of the indications for tonsil. Now coming to focal. This focal means the infection in the tonsil forms the focus for surrounding structures. So the infection originates in the tonsil, causing spread of the infection to the surrounding structures. To stop the infection for the surrounding structures, you want to remove the focus. So these are the conditions which form the focal indications for tonsil. They are persistent, non-specific JD lymphadenitis, urodynastic lymphadenitis. See, we know the most common lymph node where the which gets enlarged during tonsillitis is JD. So a recurrent chronic tonsillitis can cause persistent non-specific lymphadenitis of the JD node. So patients present with an enlarged JD node. So we'll advise for you enlarged JD node with pain. This is very important because pain represents that it's an inflammatory condition. So you'll try with antibiotics and analgesics. If the patient gets subside with this, we'll stop the treatment. But if the patient complains that there is recurrence of the similar symptoms, then we have to rule out the focus. Here, most commonly the focus is in the tonsil. So in that case, you advise the patient to go for tonsil. The next important indication is TB lymphadenitis. And other one is ear infection due to tonsil. See, tonsil is a part of a wild air cell. So whenever there is chronic inflammation or infection of the tonsils, invariably the other structures in the wild air cell like adenoids, tubal tonsils, lingual tonsils may also get hypertrophied. So in that cases, this causes obstruction of the eustachian tube, causing SOM. If the fluid in the middle ear gets infected, it becomes ASOM. If the ASOM is not treated, it progresses slowly into chronic secretory otitis media. In these cases also, you want to remove the focus of the infection that is within the tonsil. So you'll advise the patient to go for tonsil. Now coming to systemic causes. See, this tonsil infection can exacerbate already existing condition within the patient. So if the patient is having some systemic condition, but this tonsil is aggravating it, you try to remove the tonsil and so to decrease the systemic complex. Examples are of the respiratory system, chronic bronchitis, and exacerbation of the asthma. See, asthma is a condition, is usually a genetic condition. In most of the asthmatic cases, it's genetic. So patient has this complaint right from the childhood. Whenever asthma gets exaggerated, it's always due to a triggering factor. If you feel the trigger for this asthmatic attack is within the tonsil or within the infection of the tonsil, so we'll indicate or we'll advise the patient to go for tonsil. Now coming to cardiovascular conditions. rheumatic heart disease. You know, the most common cause for acute tonsillitis is beta hemolytic streptococcus. So this beta hemolytic streptococcus incites a type 3 hypersensitivity reaction, causing the body's own immune system to attack the valves of the heart, causing rheumatic heart disease. And also, if this prolonged tonsil infection can cause bacteremia, this bacteremia can cause subacute bacterial endocarditis. Okay. Now coming to renal conditions, same. Acute glomerulonephritis. It occurs due to type 3 hypersensitivity reaction. The antibody, antigen-antibody complexes get lodged into the glomerulus. Then the body autoimmune reaction causes, hypersensitivity reaction causes damage to the glomerulus, thereby causing acute renal failure. When you take the urine sample, you can find RBC casts in the urine. So, if the patient is suspected of acute glomerulonephritis, you have ruled all other conditions except for oropharyngeal condition, then you advise the patient to go for tonsil. Other cutaneous conditions like urticaria and erythema multiforme, and ophthalmic conditions like flectanular conjunctivitis and pruritus. Ortho conditions like rheumatoid arthritis. Here it is autoimmune. Okay. Now coming to, you can hear me, right? You're able to understand what I'm saying, right? Is the pace good, or you want me to go a little more slower? Just reply. See, every point here is important for your, even for your PG bits, 2 marks questions, and also for your Viva. Okay. So each and every investigation we do has some reason. We are not doing anything blind. Okay. Now coming to other approaches. See, these approaches are done. These procedures or these conditions, in these conditions, there is no abnormality in the tonsil. We are doing tonsillectomy simply as a part of procedure. Now coming to Eagle syndrome. Eagle syndrome is nothing but elongated styloid process, characterized by elongated styloid process causing compression of the glossopharyngeal nerve, causing pain symptoms. So patient presents with chronic pain. Patient takes multiple cycles of conservative treatment, but patient says that pain is not subsiding. Then we should suspect this Eagle syndrome. To diagnose this Eagle syndrome, we have to take a orthopantomogram. You know, a dental X-ray, that is nothing but orthopantomogram. In that, you can visualize the elongated styloid process. If that is not possible or it is not available, then we will advise for going CT scan. So, if the length of the styloid process is more than say 3 centimeters, it is abnormal. In these cases, you want to remove the elongated styloid process. There are 2 approaches. Either you can go from externally by giving incision or transorally through the oral cavity. Through the oral cavity is safer because when you go externally, the carotid artery, internal jugular vein all come in the way. You have to retract the structures and remove, which is a big procedure. So what you do is, you simply do a tonsillectomy and you remove the tonsil, you visualize the superior constricta muscle, you take an artery, separate the fibers of the superior constricta, then you feel for this elongated styloid process and you remove. So in this procedure, there is tonsil is absolutely normal, but we are performing this tonsillectomy as a part of the procedure. Similarly for glossopharyngeal nerve. You know, glossopharyngeal nerve forms one of the structures of the bed of the tonsil. So to reach the bed of the tonsil, we have to remove the tonsil. So we are advised tonsil. Similarly, this is a rare condition, that is the distal end, to remove the distal end of the bronchial fistula. This is a rare condition. Okay. And also in snoring surgery, that is below palatopharyngoplasty, what you do is, to do tonsillectomy also as a part of the procedure. This procedure is particularly done for patient with sleep apnea syndrome and snoring. UPP is also 2 marks question. It will be discussed later. Now coming to what are the indications? Normally tonsillectomy means we are doing on both sides. There are certain conditions which are usually not followed today. The where tonsillectomy is done only on one side. They are for excision biopsy. You find irregular surface of the tonsil or irregular ulcer. You suspect a malignancy. You remove the tonsil. You send for biopsy. Tonsillar length. We have discussed this before. Is usually a unilateral condition. Tonsillar cyst. Same. Tonsillar foreign body. Where foreign body cannot be removed, or it is becoming difficult to remove the foreign body, go for tonsillectomy. And stylectomy. Finally, glossopharyngeal uretectomy. But nowadays, when you do surgery for even these procedures, we usually do on both sides. Okay? But for a matter of in examination, they may ask you, then you have to remember all these conditions. Now coming to contraindications. Always, when there are indications, there are contraindications for any surgery. These contraindications can be absolute or relative. So example for absolute are blood dyscrasias. Blood dyscrasias means like hemophilias, purpuras, and leukemias. Pulsatile tonsil. So whenever you try to operate on a person after opening the boy and his mouth gag, if you see pulsations on the tonsil, then that is an indication to abandon the surgery at that moment, because if the person has an aberrant artery from the internal carotid artery, or a person is having an aneurysm, if you damage it, there will be torrential bleeding, and there is no way, or it is very difficult to resuscitate these patients. So, if you find pulsations during the tonsillectomy and you suspect an aneurysm or an aberrant artery from the internal carotid artery, then you invariably go for abandonment of the surgery. And finally, the important contraindication is epidemic of poliomyelitis. In a case where in an area where there is endemic polio or there is recent outbreak of polio, this tonsillectomy is contraindicated, because once you do tonsillectomy, there is raw area in the oropharynx. There will be easy transmission of this polio virus. Nowadays, except for this aneurysm of internal carotid artery, all these above cases, like this hemophilias, purpuras, leukemias, can also be managed, and surgery can also be done in these conditions. But they are difficult. Okay? So when they ask absolute name only one or two, then we have to name these two things, that is pulsatile tonsils and epidemic or endemic area of poliomyelitis. Now coming to relative contraindications. Acute conditions. In any acute inflammatory conditions, there is vasodilatation, erythema. In these conditions, there is high blood flow to the area. If you do surgery, there will be massive bleeding. Same with the upper respiratory infection. In age less than 5 years, it is not an indication for tonsillectomy. You usually avoid in less than 5 years age group. And other chronic illnesses like diabetes, asthma, allergies, this is a relative contraindication. Use of contraceptive pills and aspirins, these are relatively contraindicated, because they can affect the extrinsic and intrinsic pathways of coagulation. Thereby, they may be bleeding in the postoperative period. Only for that reason, there is a relative contraindication. You ask the patient to stop these drugs before 1 week of the surgery. But nowadays, even that, they are not clearly indicated. Okay? Normally, in old days, they used to ask the patient to stop using oral contraceptives and aspirin before 7 days of the surgery. Now, coming to investigations. Investigations include protein, hemogram, that is hemoglobin, RBC count, WBC count. This hemogram this hemoglobin is important, because you want to know if the person is fit for surgery or not. if the patient is anemic, you will usually not go for surgery, because if there is postoperative bleeding, already the person heart is on strain because it is pumping harder because already the patient is anemic. You don't want to further jeopardize the condition. The patient may go to shock immediately if there is even minimum amount of bleeding. So hemoglobin amount is important. That's why you do this routine CBC condition. Routine urinary examination, I told you before, if there is glomerular nephritis, you want to know beforehand. So you want to do urine microscopy to see if there are any casts or not. Bleeding and clotting time you do for any surgery, because you want to rule out bleeding disorders and clotting disorders before posting the patient for surgery. Chest X-ray is for fitness for surgery. ECG also for fitness for surgery, because in most of the cases you want to do this tonsillectomy under general anesthesia. These are most of these investigations are for general anesthesia. Fitness for general anesthesia. Now coming to surgery. Before going to surgery, you want to get familiarized with the instruments. So this is Boyle Davis mouth. So this is the tongue blade and this is the gag. Okay, so this is to lift the tongue up, and this, you can see this bit, this will get lodged to the teeth. I'll show you again in next slides. Okay, so this is Boyle Davis mouth. It has two parts, tongue blade and the gag itself. So again, two instruments here. This is Draffin's, the Draffin. Draffin, okay? Draffin bipods. Bipods because they're two in number. And this is Magaron's plate. Magaron. M. Magaron's plate. See, these are arranged in this way. Okay? And the Boyle Davis mouth gag hangs from this side, like this down. Okay? This is to stabilize and hold the instrument. See, you're seeing this curve is a hook like thing, right? The hook will be present, hooked onto this ring here. Okay? So the function of this Draffin's bipod is for stabilizing the mouth gag. This is the Dennis Brown tonsil holding forceps to hold the tonsil while incision and dissecting. This is sponge holder. Sponge holder. Okay, this is to hold the sponge and to apply the pressure in the forceps. This is the Mollison tonsil dissector. So with this end, you'll dissect the tonsil from its bed, and this end for retracting the anterior pillar. With this part, you'll retract the anterior pillar. So this is Mollison tonsil dissector and anterior pillar retractor. This instrument has two functions. This is Eves tonsillar snare. See, this is the snare part. Okay, wire, metal wire. This is artery forceps, simply Birkitt's long artery forceps. Birkitt, B-I-R-K-E-T-T. Birkitt's straight forceps. This is Negus forceps. Negus forceps. Okay, now coming to procedure. You're able to understand, right? Everything? You're getting it right? Okay. See, most of the times you go for general anesthesia. What is the inhalation anesthetic commonly preferred in children? Pharmacology. So this usually you use sevoflurane. Position. This is very important. The position we use in concentration is Rose position. Rose position is named after the scientist. This position is nothing but extension at the neck and extension at the atlanto-axial joint. So two extensions. Extension at the neck, extension at the atlanto-axial joint. Okay? This position is achieved by placing a pillow or a sandbag under the shoulder and a ring at supporting the head. See? Pillow under the shoulder and ring at the head. You can see there is extension at this level and also the extension is this level. Okay, so extension at the neck, extension at the atlanto-axial joint. This is the Rose position. Okay, so whenever you give anesthesia and patient is in this Rose position, you can see this is the airway, this is the endotracheal tube. Okay, so this is the mouth gap. We operate to, surgeon is present here at the head end of the patient. And you perform the surgery transorally to remove this tonsil. Okay? So, you can see the extension is here and also here. Okay? You're getting it right? Okay. Anywhere if you find it is you are not able to understand, just message me in the chat. I will stop and I will again. Okay. Suppose if you want to do the tonsillectomy in the local anesthesia, you have to infiltrate the local area to numb this area. The tonsil is supplied by glossopharyngeal now along with palatine branch from V2 and other pharyngeal branches from V3. So you want to anesthetize these areas by giving 1% lignocaine in these areas in these four areas. So anesthetize the area before going for tonsil. So now coming to methods of tonsillectomy: dissection and snare method. This is a cold steel procedure. Cold steel means we are using metallic instruments, diathermine. We are using bipolar cautery to operate this case. Current, electric current you are using. So electrocautery or diathermine. Coablation. In coablation, we'll use a wand. Coablation wand. It is like this. With two electrodes. So you perform this coablation in a saline or saline medium. By this has a port to eject saline. Okay. Whenever the electric current is passed, it dissociates the salt solution into sodium ions. These sodium ions in this fluid state, they are called plasma. So there is a state in physics known as plasma. So apart from solids, liquids and gases, there is a state which is known as plasma. It contains charged particles. Okay, these charged particles dissociate the tissue by breaking the bonds, covalent bonds between the molecules or at the cell junctions, and they dissociate these junctions and they disintegrate the tissue, causing the removal. This is known as coablation. In ultrasonic dissection, we use harmonic scalpel. Harmonic scalpel. This uses ultrasonic waves. Ultrasonic waves. In laser, we are commonly used. There are many lasers. We are using CO2 laser because this CO2 laser has additional hemostatic action at the surrounding tissue. So we use this laser. Guillotine capsulotomy techniques and this guillotine method. This is also a cold steel method similar to this, but we are not doing this because it has more chance for hemorrhage. Okay. Now we are going to procedure. So we have kept the patient in supine position, head and neck in rose position after giving anesthesia. The next step is to open the mouth of the patient to visualize the tonsil. So to open the mouth, we are using an instrument called Boyle-Davis mouth gap. See, this is the Boyle-Davis mouth gap. This is the tongue blade. Okay, so the tongue blade is pushing the tongue in this direction, and these clamp-like things, which are supporting the teeth, and they're pushing the upper jaw in this direction. Now we are visualizing the tonsil, and there is a safety mechanism here. This gets locking mechanism. So once you pull this tongue blade in this direction and you open the mouth adequately, we lock here. So the position stays as is. So it is a self-retaining speculum. Okay? Once you lock it, it stays in that position. But to support this entire instrument, we are using this Draffin's bipods. These Draffin's bipods cannot hang in air, right? So we are stabilizing this Draffin's bipod over a Magron's plate like this. Okay. This is the setup. By the end of these steps, what happens is we are opening the mouth adequately so that you can visualize those tonsils. Okay? You understood, right? First, you introduce the gag inside the mouth. You pull this lever upside, tongue blade upwards, so that it retracts the tongue up and it opens the mouth. Once you reach the desired amount of exposure, you lock it in place and you hang this gag over this contraption made of Draffin's bipods and Magron's plate. So at the end of these steps, what we achieve is we are opening the patient mouth adequately. So next step is the upper part of the tonsil is held with the tonsil holding forceps and pulled medially inferior. Okay, so we are seeing. So this is the view of the surgeon. Surgeon is sitting behind the head of the patient. Patient is in supine position with his head in extended position. So once you open the gag, this is the view we'll get of the tonsil. Okay, so next step is, normally we'll use a tonsil holding forceps. This is not the tonsil holding forceps, but there are several methods to do tonsillectomy. You can also use this simple non-toothed forceps also. Okay, what he's doing is holding the upper part of the tonsil and dragging it medially. Okay, in this direction, medially. So first step is to hold the upper pole of the tonsil and drag it medially. So the next point is the mucosa is incised with blunt scissors, knife, toothed forceps or diathermy. So the site of giving incision is the semilunar mucosal fold. I taught you in the anatomy, which is a fold that reflects from the upper pole of the tonsil to palatoglossus. Okay? You want to give incision in that fold. So site is semilunar fold in the upper pole, but method of giving incision is your choice. Either you can do with scissors, knife, forceps or electrocautery, that is diathermy. So here we are using scissors. You are giving the incision in the upper pole, then extending the incision inferiorly. See, patient is in supine and head is in the extended portion. So this is the upper pole of the tonsil and this is the lower pole of the tonsil. Don't get confused. Patient is like this. So the upper pole appears lower here. So this is the upper pole and this is the lower pole. So with the incision, we are holding the upper pole of the tonsil, driving it medially, giving the incision in the semilunar fold and slowly extending the incision downwards into the lower pole. See, so what is that we are trying to do here? We are giving the incision on the mucosa, not on the tonsil, not on the anterior pillar, but the mucosa intervening between these two structures. So we are giving the incision on the mucosa, extending it up to the lower pole. And we are also want to reach the plane. What plane you want to reach? The loose areolar tissue plane, because there is no vasculature except for the paratonsil lying in this place. Okay. So the next step is, so give the incision. Next step is blunt dissection from its bed. Okay. And where you want to dissect, the plane of dissection is loose areolar tissue, separating the tonsil from its bed. Okay. So you gave the incision, you are separating the mucosa. So this is the loose areolar tissue. This is the white thing, is the loose areolar tissue. So you want to dissect in this plane. So we are using this Mollison and dissector, tonsil dissector, and you're dissecting from upper pole to the lower pole, separating the tonsil from the bed of the tonsil. This is the loose areolar tissue plane. And this is the capsule, white thing is the capsule. Okay. Okay. So you are dissected and reached up to the inferior pole of the tonsil. So once the lower pole of the tonsil is reached, the tonsillar snare is passed over the tonsil holding forceps and placed over the lower pole, and it is tightened to crush the pedicle and tonsil is removed. See, we have dissected, this is the lower pole or pedicle. We dissected up to here. What you do is, now you guide this snare through the tonsil up to the lower pole. Okay. Once you reach here, you tighten the snare. So the snare size decreases slowly and it holds, it crushes the lower pole and ultimately cuts, because it cuts because it is a metallic wire. So once you cut the tonsil here, in this direction here, you remove the tonsil with this tonsil holding forceps. So at this step, at the end of this step, tonsil is removed. So what is the next step? You want to prevent bleeding. So you keep the gauze in the tonsillar forceps using the sponge holder we are talking about before. And the bleeding points are looked for, and the bleeding points are arrested with non-absorbable sutures. See, you remove the tonsil now. We are looking for bleeding point. Suppose this is the bleeding point. So you'll hold the bleeding point with the Birkitt's straight artery forceps. Then you take the curved Neger's forceps and you place this Neger forceps below the bleeding point. See, this is the bleeding point, but the Neger's forceps is holding here. So this is the bleeding vessel. The Neger's is holding below the Neger, below the bleeding vessel. Once you hold the vessel like this, you will engage a thread like this and you place a knot to arrest the bleeding. Okay. If this is not possible, we go for bipolar quandary. See, it has two electrodes. Current flows between these two electrodes. So, this is like forceps. So, What you do is you hold this bleeding point with this forceps and you press the button. Once you press the button, the current flows between these two electrodes and this tissue gets burned and that vessel will be closed. Okay? So this is the end of the tonsillectomy surgery. Now coming to post-operative care. So immediately after the patient recovers from anesthesia, you will keep the patient in left lateral position to prevent aspiration. Then we will not give the patient any oral foods for 6 hours, because in GA there will be gastric paresis, paralysis of the muscles of the GAT. So if you give food, there is no peristalsis, there will be intestinal obstruction. Okay, that's why you avoid food. And also, if the patient vomits, there will be aspiration. So you monitor the vitals. You monitor the vitals and you look for what is known as swallowing sign. Usually, you perform this surgery in younger patients. They are usually drowsy post-operatively. What they do is, if there is bleeding, they keep on swallowing the blood. So, if you find the patient is having recurrent swallowing symptoms, then you suspect there is some post-operative bleeding. You advise cold foods and ice creams, you know, any other cold foods to incite a local vasoconstriction so that there will be decreased bleeding. Along with that, antibiotics and analgesics are indicated. Now coming to complications. So complications can occur during the surgery and after the surgery. Complications during the surgery are known as intraoperative complications. So when you talk about intraoperative complications, you should talk about right from anesthesia. Once the patient enters the OT room, every step can have complications. The first step is anesthesia. So complications related to anesthesia, like arrhythmias, hypotension, bronchospasm, always can occur. Next, surgery. Invariably, in any surgery, the prime complaint is hemorrhage. Hemorrhage can occur most commonly due to unprepared case. That is, patient is still having the infection, you have not controlled it with antibiotics, and you post this for the surgery. Because there is some inflammation, in any inflammatory area, there is vasodilatation. So when you operate, there will be bleeding. How do you stop this primary hemorrhage? Simple. I told you before. Either by packing the fossa with the gauze, that is by applying pressure. Second one is by applying knots or ligature. Third one is cautery. And also we are using here what is known as chemical cautery by using hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide is a unstable molecule. It spontaneously gives nascent oxygen. This nascent oxygen, when this peroxide is applied to the raw surface, this peroxide releases nascent oxygen. This nascent oxygen has vasoconstrictor effect, decreasing the pain. Second thing is, this reaction of hydrogen peroxide giving water molecule and an oxygen free radical, that is nascent oxygen, is an exothermic reaction. That is, heat is released while this oxygen molecule gets dissociated. So this released heat is enough to coagulate small capillaries. So it has a coagulative action also along with it. And also this nascent oxygen is an antiseptic, acts as an antiseptic to the body. So these are the functions of hydrogen peroxide. Now coming to trauma. So right from introduction of the gag, you can injure the teeth, lips, tongue, palate, anterior pillar, posterior pillar, teeth. See? So by introducing the gag, you can injure all these structures. So all these form the complications. Okay. Second thing is aspiration. So while keeping the rose position, the dependent area is in the nasopharynx. So all the blood that gets oozed or there is hemorrhage gets collected into the nasopharynx, but it doesn't go into the larynx and airway. So that is a main reason or main advantage for rosebush. Apart from, even in spite of that, there may be chance of aspiration if there is massive amount of bleeding. And also while removing tonsil, as part of the tonsil piece can get aspirated into the lungs. To prevent this, we usually use a cuff endotracheal tube. So that's what it is written here. To prevent this, we'll apply use a cuffed endotracheal tube. If it is non-cuff, you pack the surrounding area with a ribbon gauze. And rose potion also gives some protection against this aspiration. And post-operatively, left lateral position, because the left bronchus is longer and of lesser diameter than the right bronchus. So aspiration into the right bronchus and the right lung is more common in the left lung. So we advise the patient to go into the left lateral position or comma position. Now coming to post-operative complications. There are two complications, important complications. Reactionary hemorrhage and secondary hemorrhage. Reactionary hemorrhage occurs within the first 24 hours of the surgery. The main cause is dislodgement of the clot or slipping of the ligature, or if the patient is constantly coughing, coughing causes increased intravascular pressures and these vessels are already formed clot get opened up and the bleeding will occur. And also, if you remember the base bed of the tonsil, I think this is the superior constrictor muscle fibers like this. The blood vessels, they pass in between these fibers and enter the tonsil. So whenever this muscle gets contracted, the vessels get constricted. There will be additional pressure on the vessels. So in anesthesia, what happens is all the muscles get relaxed. So when this gets relaxed, there will be a gap between the muscle fibers and the vessels, they have no pressure surrounding them. There will be more amount of bleeding. So clinical features during this reaction hemorrhage, or how can you suspect this hemorrhage? This rattling noises during breathing, swallowing movements, raised pulse rate and respiratory rate because loss of blood, hypovolemic shock, increased heart rate. Fallen BP is due to hypovolemic shock, hypovolemia. Child appears as pale, sweating, and in shock. These are all the features of shock. Okay. How do you manage? Left lateral position, assess the blood loss, amount of blood loss, send for blood bank, bring a bag after doing cross matching. If the patient condition deteriorates, we have to give blood, and before that, immediately start with IV fluids. Okay. Once you stabilize the condition after giving IV fluids, we have to identify the bleeding vessel and we have to cauterize again under general anesthesia. After this, if there is more amount of blood loss, we'll give blood, whole blood. So, if all the things fail, all like ligation, cautery, then what you do is you'll suture both the pillars. These are two pillars, will approximate like this, so that more amount of pressure will exit on the vessel. Then we hope that bleeding stops. Even if that doesn't stop, we'll give an incision in the neck, identify the external thyroid artery, and ligate it above the branch of the superior thyroid artery. Next is the secondary hemorrhage. It occurs 1 to 7 days after the surgery. The main cause is infection or sepsis. So immediately before discharging the patient, we have to advise the patient about the red flag signs. That is, if there is bleeding within the 1 week, immediately have to bring the patient to the hospital setup. Then you will evaluate and you do whatever is required. The other complications are edema of the uvula. See, uvula is a muscular organ with a mucosa. So whenever you meddle with it, there will be edema. Aspiration pneumonia, we discussed about this. Change in voice, because if there are large tonsils for long term, if you remove the tonsil, suddenly there is more space. More space means more space for resonance. So voice changes in some patients. So this reflexatalgia, TMJ, temporomandibular gland dislocation. if you extend or put more pressure on the mouth gap, this jaw joint gets dislocated. More extension, hyperextension can cause dislocation of the adductor-axial joint. More commonly, it occurs in patients with Down syndrome. So, now coming to adenoid. So, it is a procedure where adenoids are removed. There are several methods to do adenoidectomy. Here we discuss about doing adenoidectomy using a St. Clair Thompson adenoid curator. We discuss only that method. So usually, if the adenoids are diagnosed by doing a nasopharyngeal X-ray, even in tonsillectomy cases, you want to do adenoidectomy in the same setting. Indications: nasal obstruction, because adenoids are enlarged, posterior part of the nasal cavity and nasopharynx is occupied with adenoid, causing nasal obstruction. This nasal obstruction, if it is severe, it causes mouth breathing. If this severe mouth breathing continues for a long time, it causes adenoid facies. I talked about what is adenoid facies before. So chronic adenoiditis can cause continuous nasal discharge, and enlarged adenoids obstructing the airway causes obstructive sleep apnea. So all these are indications for adenoiditis. And secondary infections due to adenoids. Adenoid, large adenoids obstructing the eustachian tube orifice causes SVM, ASVM, and CSVM. In that case, it is adenoiditis indicated. Bronchitis. Adenoiditis, chronic adenoiditis is triggering repeated attacks of bronchitis, indication for surgery. Recurrent upper respiratory infection causing cervical lymphadenitis, indication for adenoid. Contraindication similar to the tonsil. Okay. Methods we are using: adenoid curette. So adenoid curette, microdebrider, and coablation. Procedure, anesthesia and position is same as tonsillectomy. What you will do is, after keeping the position, after keeping the patient in the gauze position, you take adenoid curette, you will hold it like a dagger, and you will feel, this is the posterior end of the nasal septum. With this instrument, you will feel for this posterior end of the nasal septum. From there, you will do sweeping movements by holding the instrument like a dagger, like this. Okay? In this direction. Okay? This curette has a cage, and initially you use a cage to trap the adenoid tissue. After that, subsequent points, you will remove the cage and you will do the adenoidectomy. You should take care that you should not injure the paramedian structures like eustachian tube orifices. Same instructions as in tonsillectomy. Complications are similar: primary reaction, secondary hemorrhage. Most important thing regarding the trauma, you have to remember that you should not injure the eustachian tube orifices. Okay. Now I show you a video. Can you see me? Once reply, I'll start the video. Okay. See, now we'll see the video of the tonsillectomy. See, this is just a prototype video. See, patient is in the supine position. This is the tongue blade, and this is the mouth guard. Once you open the Boyle Davis mouth gag, this is the view of the tonsils you have. See, this is the mouth gag, and this is the stand. Once you open the mouth gag, this is the view of the tonsil you have. Okay. First, we are dealing with the adenoid. See, this is the Saint Clair Thompson adenoid curette, and this is the cage. See, for this cage has a spike-like structures to trap the adenoid tissue. See, what we are following procedure is a blind procedure. First, you palpate with the finger and feel for the adenoid. Then you introduce the adenoid curette, feel for the posterior end of the nasal septum, then you do a sweeping movement. Now, he's introducing the instrument, feeling for the posterior end of the nasal septum, and engaging the adenoid, and doing the sweeping movements. See, this is the adenoid tissue. Can you appreciate? This is the adenoid tissue. The spike-like structure here has trapped the adenoid tissue. Okay, you can, after removing the adenoid, you can palpate again. If you feel that some amount of adenoid is left, again you do the second time. Okay, after doing the adenoidectomy, to stop the bleeding, you will introduce a gauze piece into the nasopharynx through the oral cavity. See how he is introducing through the oral cavity. He is introducing into the See, this is the teeth of the upper jaw. This is the teeth of the lower jaw. This is the hard palate. This is the tongue. Okay, he's introducing. Now we are coming to tonsillectomy. Upper end of the tonsil is held, pulled medially. That is the food particle stuck into the crypta magna. He's removing it. Now he is giving the incision with the tooth to forceps, because you can use any instrument. He is using tooth to forceps, and he is giving the incision in the semilunar fold, which is the mucosal fold, from upper end of the tonsil to the pillar. See, this is the pillar. Okay, he is not giving incision on the pillar. He is giving the incision on the mucosa. This is the pillar. On giving the incision, he is extending the incision inferior and separating the mucosal fold from the upper part of the anterior pillar. See, he is pulling the tonsil medially. So he is dissecting. Normally we dissect with the Mollison tonsil dissector, but there are several methods for dissection. He is using just a cotton ball to dissect the tonsil from the surrounding bed in the plane of the loose areola tissue. See, he is separating the tonsil. See, this is the capsule of the tonsil, and the bed of the tonsil is inside. Okay, he is separating the capsule of the tonsil is intact. See, this is a whitish structure. He is separating the in the plane between the capsule and the bed of the tonsil. And see, this is the mucosal tag attached to the tonsil. He is removing that also, and is going from upper pole to the lower pole. Instead of dissector, he is using forceps here to dissect. You can use any instrument. See, this is the loose areola tissue space. See, this is the this empty space is the loose areola tissue space. This one. This white thing is the capsule. Okay. He is trying to separate the mucosal attachments to the lower pole, lower pedicle. This is the pedicle. Pedicle is nothing but where the artery, main artery, tonsillar branch of facial artery enters the tonsil. So he is separating the tonsil from the surrounding mucosa. And this is only the lower pole. You can see, right? Now he is engaging the snare and tightening at the lower pole. He is tightened so hard that it ultimately cuts it. So crushes and cuts it. The idea to crush the tonsil here is it releases the endothelial tissue thromboplastin, which is a potent vasoconstrictor. That's why you're not simply cutting it. You're crushing with the snare and ultimately cutting it to remove it. See, he's tightening that, ultimately the tonsil is removed and it is sent for histopathological examination. Now, first step is to apply pressure. Since you cannot apply with the finger, you're stuffing the fossa with the gauze pieces. See, this instrument is the Mollison's anterior pillar retractor and dissector. Now he is using the anterior pillar retractor end to retract the anterior pillar so that you can see what is in the fossa. See, he is retracting the anterior pillar. Okay. See, he is retracting the anterior pillar. Okay, this is the fossa. Now he is looking for any bleeders, if there is any bleeding points or not. Okay. So tonsillectomy surgery is incomplete without hemostasis, that is stopping the bleeding. So he has removed the two tonsils, this is the adenoid tissue, and he will send these three for histopathological examination. Okay. So you understood, right? Please reply. You have seen the video, right? Everybody. Okay. So read the procedure again, because it's very important. That's why I have repeated the second time. So I'll end the class here now. Okay. Thank you. If you have any doubts, just mail me. Okay? Okay, thank you. Take care. Thank you.